Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110. Now, here's this week's message.
Well, good morning. How are you? We are in a series, just a three-part series, called Brand New. It's a brand new series, so it's brand new. It's a brand new year, and that's part of the reason that I decided to go and talk about this because, you know, new year, kind of you have new expectations, new hopes, maybe New Year's resolutions, and sometimes those don't turn out like we hoped. And so what does it really mean to have something brand new? You know, the Bible talks about being brand new. And at the top of your outline, if you pull your outline with me, we're going to cover a couple of scriptures from Bible verses. They're also on the side of the screens there. Notice it says, when somebody becomes a Christian. That's an important phrase. I wonder how most people would answer that. When somebody becomes a Christian, they become more religious. When somebody becomes a Christian, they become a do-gooder. When somebody comes to Christian, they get baptized, they go to church. But that's not what the Bible says. Notice it says, when somebody becomes a Christian, he becomes a brand new person. Where? Inside. He's not the same anymore. A new life has begun. And so when we're frustrated with our life, when we're wondering, hey, how do I break this habit? How can I have kind of a new start, a new angle at this thing? We often try external things. I'm going to change my schedule. I'm going to change my diet. I'm going to change my eating experience. I'm going to change it. But the Bible says that it begins from the inside. That's how God works. On the inside, we become brand new inside. And so we don't get caught up in the resolution dilemma, which is always trying to influence our lives from the outside in. From the inside out. Listen, if you want the best year of your life to be this coming year, 2017. Make it the best year spiritually. If you have the best year spiritually in 2017, it will be the best year of your life. It'll be terrific. One of the ways, now we have things that we rally around in the church here. We rally around certain things to help us because we all have the same goal. One of those things is small groups. If you get involved in a small group, it's going to help your life. It's going to help your spiritual life. We have a lot of small groups. We have a lot of people in small groups. But, you know, last week we had an emphasis, a small group sign up. 145 people signed up, people that weren't in small groups. That's terrific, 145 people. Many of you here represent that, right? You're saying, yeah, I'm one of those. And there will be a spiritual warfare going on. Like, you'll think, maybe I don't need that after all. But I'm telling you, if you want the best year of your life to be 2017, make it the best year of your life spiritually. And see if God doesn't bless that. See if he doesn't start to work on the inside and out instead of the outside in. Now, the most common resolution is physical, right? We all, you know, I could lose a couple pounds. I should probably eat a little better. And we read stuff. I mean, I've read things, you know, like one of the things that I've tried to do is that technique where you, I don't know if you've heard this. See, in the morning, you eat like a king. Right? And you can eat anything you want. You know, buffet, anything. In the afternoon, you eat like a prince. So in other words, scale back some. And in the evening, you eat like a pauper. Have you heard that before? Eat like a king in the morning, eat like a prince in the afternoon, eat like a pauper at night. But the problem is, for me, a little voice is calling in my head that says, long live the king. That's why I eat like a king all the time. You know, when we read, you know, techniques and external things, we find ourselves often missing what we really want. So God wants to change that. I think that this year could be a big year for you, a big year of change, but it's going to have to start from the inside out. You know, when we let our bodies dictate things, when we let our senses, because our senses, they have big needs, you know, and that's what everybody, if you, that's your body. You look around, that's the part of it. There's more of us than just that. But when we let our bodies dictate and call the shots, there's a Bible word for that. You write this down. You find it in lists in the New Testament. It's the word debauchery. We don't use that word too often, right? Debauchery. But it's a word that means that you have excess, your senses are living in excess. They're calling the shots. They're in control. And that hurts you as a person because you're more than just your body. God made you, I don't know if you know this, but God made you a triune being, just like himself. He's the Trinity, and he's made of a triune. He made us in the same way. You see, we have our body. That's what we see, and our body has real cravings, real needs. We need sex. We need to eat. We need sleep, and it's screaming all the time, "Take care of me." But you're not just your body. You're also a soul, and your soul is your emotions, your mind, your will. It's all those other aspects, your soul. And your soul has needs. And so sometimes your soul kind of gets into this thing where it's controlling things and with all the emotions, you know, with anger or with things. You know, animals have a soul too. My dog, when he's sad, his little tail goes between his legs. When he's happy, it's, you know, going back and forth. Animals have souls, but no creature in God's kingdom is made with all three, which is the spirit. There's a spirit part of you. God imparted some of himself into you, and you live forever. That's a part of us that lives forever. That's different than the animal kingdom. And all three of those want to be in charge. Your body wants to call the shots. It wants to be, and it'll call the shots and not care about what happens to your soul or your spirit. When your soul is in charge, and it doesn't care about the body or the spirit, it just wants to, you know, when your emotions, some people, their emotions, they're controlling everything about them. And you'll cause you'd have body image problems, self-esteem issues. Some people, they just fall into depression. They let their depression controls it. They'll destroy themselves. They can actually literally, you know, kill themselves, letting their emotions just run amok. Or your spirit can be in control. No, God wants us to have our spirit in control. And so he talks about that, but it's not easy. You see, especially our body is so strong. At one point, Paul is so frustrated. He's the writer of a lot of the New Testament, the Apostle Paul. He gets so frustrated at one point, he calls his body the body of death. He goes, "Man, nothing good is happening here." Now notice with me, it's in Romans 7. He talks about it in Romans 7 and 8. We're only going to look at Romans 7 a little bit today. On your own, you can read Romans 8. He talks about this warring that's going on. And he says here, beginning in verse 18, he says, "For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out." He goes, I know what I want. I have this desire to do good, but I don't do it. I still click on that computer screen and that image that I don't want to look at. I still pick up the cigarettes. I still eat the thing that I shouldn't be eating. I still treat people a certain way. He goes, "I know what I'm supposed to be doing. I don't do it though." And and he's real frustrated. He goes, I want to be a good guy, but I keep falling short. He describes this in verse 19. He says, "For what I do is not the good I want to do. No, the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it." Here's an important phrase. "But it is sin living," now say these next two words with me, in me, that does it. So he says, that's the problem. It's not the external things. It's not the New Year's resolutions. It's going on in me. There's something in me that's causing me to continue to do the things I don't want to do, causing me to continue to fail myself, fail others, fail my resolutions. I can't seem to get a hold of my spending. I can't seem to get a hold of my schedule. I can't, all these things. And he goes, the problem is inside. That's what he's saying. And then he says in verse 24, he says, what a wretched man I am. You know, we use that phrase, you know, I hate you, right? I hate you. I hate myself. That's what he's saying. I hate myself. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this? And there's that phrase, body of death. He goes, I hate myself for the exploding in anger at the people I care about. I hate myself for the kind of this out of control jealousy that goes on in my life, or this bitterness that I can't seem to ever let go. I hate myself because I always eat the things that are just causing me to not achieve the goals I want to achieve. I mean, I hate myself for looking at that pornographic image over and over, and I keep gravitating. I don't want to. I know it's not helpful for my marriage. I know it's not helpful for, you know, sowing in good things for my future relationships. I do it though anyways. And he goes, oh, what a wretched thing going on here. He's frustrated with himself. So what's the solution? Notice in 25, he says, thanks be to God through Christ our Lord. Amen. That's the answer. You'd think, oh, if you don't have your weight goals under control, you join a gym. If you're not getting certain, you know, if you can't seem to control certain habits, get an accountability partner. Go get some counseling. Those things might be fine. But he says, no, it begins with going to Jesus Christ, saying it's something on the inside. If I don't deal with that, all those other things, they're not going to take me where I need to go. So he goes, it's through Christ that he's the one that makes the difference in my life. Now listen, if we let our bodies, our senses control us, it's not going to be a positive thing for us. It does three things I want to point out. Number one is it destroys us. It destroys us. Now the devil knows that once you give your life to Christ that he can't keep you from heaven, but he can certainly harass you here on earth. And he does. He wants to harass you and cause you to be disinterested, cause you to be distracted. He's all kinds of things. He's going to harass you if you let your body call the shots and make the decisions in your life. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12. Interesting phrase here. He says, everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. This is the same guy who wrote Romans 7 when he's talking about the body of death and wretched and, wretched man I am. He's all frustrated. He's going, hey, listen, I know that the things I do, they're not going to necessarily keep me from heaven, because we get to heaven because of our faith in Christ. It's not by works. It's a gift of God so that nobody can boast. Right? Ephesians tells us that. And so he goes, no, I know that's not going to keep me from heaven when I get involved in these things that I don't like doing. But it's not beneficial for me. You know, it's not helping me. And then he goes, everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. The next thing you know, we're mastered by stuff. We have addictive stuff. We have habits that we form that we're not proud of. And he goes, those are things that they master us. They're getting the best of us. It's one of the things, reasons why we do 21 days of prayer and fasting. Now, we put it in January intentionally because we came out of the most indulgent season, the holidays, right? I mean, we're just all the gift giving. There's nothing wrong with it. All the food, I love it. I mean, I make sure and eat everything that's served me. I don't want to offend the cooks. So I eat seconds and thirds and, you know, I mean, I want to make sure they know how much I appreciate them. But anyways, we come out of this highly indulgent season, and then we go into 21 days of prayer and fasting because something happens when we pray and when we fast, particularly fasting. Fasting is about this issue of mastery that Paul's talking about. You take something, you think it's something that's getting mastery over you, and you go, you know what, I'm not going to do that. With God's help, because I'm in prayer, and the support of everybody else, my small group, with God's, I'm not going to do that for 21 days. Listen, if it's got mastery over you, that's going to be a hard 21 days. It's a challenge. Now, a lot of us were fasting food type of things, but some people were fasting social media, some people fasting games, video games, phone games, all kinds of things. And there's something powerful that happens. Let me read to you a couple stories. I put in your hands your story. I had asked them to put that there because I want to hear your story. And that's my email address. I want you to either write it out right now and put it in the offering, or email it to me and tell me about your story of fasting if you're fasting. I want to hear it. I've heard some amazing stories. Here's two. First one. I fasted coffee, but I felt a whisper say caffeine. This was a good whisper because I would have just drank Mountain Dew. 10 years ago, I started to drink coffee all day, even at night. Every day, I drank more coffee than a video game programmer. So the idea of fasting seemed impossible. But I gave it to God, so I haven't had caffeine since the start of 21 days. I have never felt better. God has used this fast to bring me back to who I really am. I used to get so moody and easily agitated. I thought the change was me just getting older. I never considered it was from a 10-year-old addiction. After all, it's just coffee. I felt more relaxed at work, and I don't get agitated with my kids. Because of God's power, another part of me is made whole. Another person said this, as we were approaching the 21 days of prayer and fasting, I asked the Lord to show me what I need to fast from in my life. You see, last year had been one of difficulty for me. I had no energy, enthusiasm, or motivation. The enemy was really using this in my life. However, I felt the Lord single in on what he wanted me to fast from. I started fasting, no meats or sweets for 21 days. One day, on days 1 and 2, I really struggled. But I did not waver. I pushed into God to help me. On day 3, I woke up rejuvenated and full of clarity and energy. I was excited about life and my days ahead. I literally felt the depression break off of me. I felt great and was full of life. I thank God for having the 21 days of prayer and fasting. I feel I have a new purpose and can continue to run this race put before me with enthusiasm and to be healthy mentally, emotionally, spiritually, and physically. Yeah. I want to invite you to join us. If you're not part of the 21 days of prayer and fasting, or maybe you've fallen off, you know, and didn't get there, join and be part of it. You go, Andy, 2/3 of it's already done. Well, that's good news. You only have 7 days you have to fast then, right? That should be easier. 7 days. And just say, you know what, God, here's 7 days. 1 week. For some of you, that'll be the first time you've ever done that. And think of something that's mastering you. Now, the truth is, you might find that at the end of the 7 days, you want to continue it. Because some things in our lives, really, we don't need to have in our lives. And that's part of what happens when we fast. There's something very powerful. You go, well, what's up with fasting, Andy? I mean, well, what? As I said, we're made triune beings. And each one of those, our spirit, our soul, our body, each one wants to be in charge. And even though it hurts us if we let our body in charge, if we let that happen, it just causes all these kinds of problems. So in fasting, what you do is you take something like food, for example, where it's screaming, I want this, and you make it suffer. You go, no, you're not going to get fed right now. Or we do something maybe in the mind area or, you know, emotion. And you just, no, right now you're not going to get that. And it gives a leg up. See, it kind of lets our spirit go into hyperdrive. I used to play a game when I was a kid. It was called King of the Hill. I don't know if you've ever heard of this game. If you're younger, you probably haven't. You have a lot more stuff to do. As a kid, when I was a kid, I would just walk around. If we saw a pile of dirt, that was a game. Hey, we can make a game out of this. Nowadays, they have video games. No, we didn't have all that. You know, we just found a pile of dirt. There's a game there. And the game is simple. Somebody gets up on top, everybody tries to get them off. And, you know, you're kicking and pushing, and they're grabbing your leg and pulling. And after a while, one person's up on top. You know who that person was? The strongest, the biggest guy. Every time, it was always the biggest dude. And that's true in your life. You have kind of these things battling, your spirit, your soul, your body. Whoever is the biggest, whoever's the strongest is going to win. So when you choose to say, I'm not gonna feed that. Now we're always feeding our body and our soul and our spirit, but we're hoping that we're kind of getting ahead. But when you fast, it gives an unfair advantage to your spirit. That's the point of fasting. And it helps you to refocus, to reprioritize. It can be a very powerful thing. So, first thing, it's going to try to hurt you. Second thing, when we let our bodies call the shots, is it dilutes my witness. You go, Andy, what's that about? Well, I'm just trying to, you know, motivate you to help have you see another reason. People are watching you, if you're a Christ follower, how you live out your life. You go, what? People are telling me they're looking at me, telling me they're judging me. No judging me. You go judge yourself. All right? I don't want to be judged. That's fine if you want to have that attitude, but Jesus said, let your light shine before men, see your good deeds that they may glorify the Father in heaven. Part of the way God spreads the good news of Christ is that he has commissioned ambassadors. When you become a Christ follower, you're an ambassador for Christ. You're a billboard. Hey, this is what Jesus can do in somebody's life. And so it dilutes our witness when we are letting our senses, our bodily senses, control the things that we do, or the decisions that we make, our behavior. So it's one of the reasons why we're motivated. Say, you know what, I want to be a good ambassador. I'm not perfect. None of us are perfect, right? But we're pushing towards that effort. 2 Corinthians 8:21 says, for we are taking pains to do what is right. It's not easy. We're taking pains to do what is right, not only in the sight and the eyes of the Lord, but also in the eyes of men. In other words, we want to make God look so attractive in our imperfect lives that people go, wow, I know what you're going through. And you still have joy in your life. You still are able to trust and have faith. That's amazing. Have you heard of that song? It's a old hymn called "It Is Well with My Soul." A guy named Horatio Spafford wrote that. He was an attorney, lived in Chicago. This was before air travel, and his business was wiped out in the Chicago fire, the Great Chicago Fire. He also the same year lost his son to an illness. They were devastated, obviously, so him and his family decided to go to England and visit a friend. They were going to get on a ship, and he was held back because of some business thing that had happened. He had to stay back. The family said, we'll just go, we'll meet you in England. So his wife and his daughters, they get on the boat. The ship hits another ship and sinks, and his wife is saved, but all of his daughters drowned in the ship. She sends a telegram, says, alone saved, which means I'm the only one who made it. He's devastated, obviously. He gets on a ship to go visit comfort his wife on the who's in England. On the way, the captain goes up to him and says, we're going to actually go over the very spot where your daughters are entombed in the ocean below. He goes, I'll stop and let you pay your respects. So as the story goes, he goes out. When he stops the boat, he goes out to the bow of the ship. And he prays and he meditates, and these words come to him. And this is part of that song. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. And that song is sung to bring comfort to people that are in difficult situations and sadness, and it's a testimony of somebody. I mean, he went through, it doesn't get any worse than that, folks. Lose all your kids. And yet, in the process of that, he says, you know what? God is still at work inside me. The work that he began when I put faith in Christ, when his Holy Spirit came into me and changed me, that work is still going on. There's something that's going on that's good, that's positive. And that's a witness, no matter what you're going through. You're saying, you know what, I'm going to make sure and not forget that God's in control in this thing. Number three is it dishonors God. When we let our body call the shots and we make poor decisions because our senses are deciding for us, they're ruling the roost, it dishonors God. Now, let me explain this. The Bible says that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Now, I know this is probably new for many of you. It's a new paradigm. The temple, though, that means it's a sanctuary. That's where God dwells. God, in the Old Testament, God dwelt in a temple, in a sanctuary. But he knew that that didn't work because he couldn't influence people like he wanted to. So part of Jesus coming to earth and dying on the cross, and then the Holy Spirit, he changed locations from a sanctuary or a temple into people. People invite Christ into it, and the Holy Spirit comes into our lives. This becomes the temple, our body. Not a church. I mean, people come in through these doors, and churches all over the world, they'll come in and they'll be more reverent, kind of with respect. Some people take off their hats. They want to, you know, respect, you know, the room. But this is not the sanctuary, folks. I mean, when we started this church 22 years ago, it started in my house, and then we moved it to a couple schools. Then we went to the Cinema Cafe for a few years, and we ended up here. This is an old racquetball facility, and we renovated it. This is just walls. That's why, as you come in, I don't know if you noticed, but we have a huge sign that says auditorium. That's what this is. This is an auditorium. Why? Because the sanctuary is your body. That's what needs respect. That's where we give deference. That's where we go, oh, God's Holy Spirit lives in my body. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And so we honor God when we honor the body where he dwells. Notice what he says here in 1 Corinthians 6:15. Do you not know? In other words, to say, you don't know. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Never. He's talking about a new kind of fitness, realizing that God wants to change us. He does it from within. And it's a spiritual fitness that affects physical fitness. The connection is always there. You can try to disassociate it in your mind, but the reality is it is connected. So I dedicate this message, you know, new fitness to all of you who are frustrated physically with your, you know, you're going, man, how do I make it happen? You let God change you from within. You start to realize this is where the Holy Spirit dwells. This is his temple. This is the sanctuary. 2 Timothy 2, verses 20 and 22 says, but in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and earth. So he says, like, in your house, you have both china and paper plates. And you treat china differently. I mean, china is like, you know, it's got a special cabinet for it. And you wash it differently. You use it differently. Paper plates, who cares, right? You eat all of it, you know, and then you throw it away. Two different types of vessels, two different types of use. He says, he's making an illustration. That's how we treat ourselves. He says, and some to honor and some dishonor. If a man therefore purges himself of these, in other words, treating yourself like a paper plate, you purge yourself of that. Instead of just saying, well, it doesn't really matter what I click on, what I watch, any kind of pornographic image. It doesn't matter what I smoke or what I eat or how I behave. All those. No, this does matter. It matters. He says, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, and notice this next word, and fit. Why? For the master's use. You know, the master has need of you. He's got an assignment for you and prepared for every good work. God has a work for you, and he needs your body to accomplish it. And so you treat your body accordingly. Now, last week, I closed with four questions for you to think about if you wanted to get spiritually on a strong journey with God. And if you missed that, you can watch it online, vineyardchurch.com. You'll want to see that. I want to close this one with four more questions about how to put your body in the right perspective. Not letting it lead, but letting God lead through your body. Number one, you ask the question, am I offering daily? Some of you didn't know you were supposed to do that. Offer your bodies daily to God. Every day. God, you have need. I want you to use my body however you want. My feet should go only where you want them to go. My hands should only do what you want my hands to do. My mouth should only say the things you want me to say. I mean, you use your body unto God for his mission for you. Romans 12:1 says, therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your what? Yeah. He's interested in your body. Sometimes we think, well, you know, God's only interested in my spirit. No. No, actually, notice what he says about how you treat your body. He says, offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. And what happens? How does God perceive that when we do that? He says, this is a spiritual act of worship. See, how you treat your body, what you eat, how you treat your cardiovascular system, all of that's worship. A lot of times we just think, well, I don't know. I thought worship was like singing when we were singing earlier, or if I read my Bible, you know. Certainly that's worship too, but God says, no, actually worship is when we offer our bodies daily. I love that word daily, because it's so easy to forget, right? You read the Bible, and like we're doing a Bible study right now, you go, yeah, I should do that, and then tomorrow you forget. What were we talking about yesterday? No, he says daily, every day, realizing today is a day I'm going to honor God with my body, because that's an act of worship. Number two, am I withdrawing weekly? It's so physically unhealthy to not weekly withdraw. Do something different. Let your body rest. And this is a violation that many, many Christians and pastors make. I mean, Jesus said things like, the Sabbath is made for man, not man for the Sabbath. And so some people think, oh, well, then the Sabbath isn't important. No, what Jesus was saying, don't get all legalistic about it. He talked about the legalism of the Pharisees and how they lived in bondage because of that. He goes, no, it's not a legalism thing, but it doesn't mean it's not important. Nowhere did Jesus say, hey, listen, the old man missed it with the Sabbath. You don't have to do that. No, he didn't say that. He says, no, this is an important thing, the Sabbath. And by resting, it helps us to align all those things together. And sometimes people say, well, I'm just too busy. I need that extra day to do all this extra work. And, it might mean that our schedule is just too busy then. We need to realign things. Brian Regan, that comedian, he talks about just being too busy. He says, you're so busy, you don't even eat a healthy breakfast. You just eat Pop-Tarts. Then he said he was noticing there's directions on the Pop-Tarts that says you can toast them. That'll be about 30 seconds or so. He says, but there's microwave directions. He goes, if you don't have time for the toaster, you're already eating a Pop-Tart. That throw it in the microwave 3 seconds. Brian says, listen, something's out of whack if you don't have 27 seconds to eat a Pop-Tart, extra seconds. I mean, some of us, we're just too busy. And so we need to realign and say, you know what, this is important. Because the body is the temple of the Spirit. I need it to rest. One guy said, well, if the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, man, I made my body into a mega church. But I don't think that's what the Bible's talking about, right? That was a weird joke, I know. Okay. Notice here, Isaiah 58, it's a great chapter on fasting. It's talking, on the Sabbath. It's the whole thing's about the Sabbath, honoring the Sabbath. I pulled out a little bit of it. He says, if you keep your feet from breaking the Sabbath and from doing as you please on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the Lord's holy day honorable, a lot of ifs there, right? And if you honor it by not going your own way and not doing as you please or speaking idle words, then you will find your joy in the Lord. And I will cause you to ride on the heights of the land and to feast on the inheritance of your father Jacob. The mouth of the Lord has spoken. He's talking about, hey, we get rested so that we can ride on the heights of the land. We get our strength back. We get renewed. God built it into the fabric of the way we're wired. 13 years ago, I decided I was significantly heavier than I am today. And I thought, you know what? I don't think that's honoring God. I had never really thought of it, actually. So it was about 13 years ago when what we're talking about today became new for me. And so I thought, I'm going to join a gym. So I go to a gym and I start working out every day. That's kind of my temperament. I'm kind of an all or nothing type guy. So every day I'm in it, man. I'm every day. And yet 3 months go by, nothing's changed, zero. And so I get frustrated. I think, 3 months, man, I mean, what's going on with this? So I go and I talk to this trainer. And she's just a young girl. She looks like she's 20 or something. I think, I hope I know as much as she knows. But evidently I didn't, So I sit down. I tell her my situation. She goes, okay, let me repeat this. She goes, you're telling me you have been working out every day for 3 months. I said, yes. And you haven't seen any change? No. She goes, she didn't know what I did for a living. She goes, have you ever thought of taking one day off a week? I thought, well, this isn't the time to tell her I'm a pastor, I said, you know what? I'm going to take that advice. So I did, and then within a few weeks, I started seeing a change. Within 6 weeks, I was at the goal weight I was looking for. And I just think God honors it. There's something to the Sabbath. You know, Napoleon tried to get rid of the Sabbath and make it a 10-day work week. And the people started getting sick. The economy started going belly up. And then he changed it back. I mean, it's just God designed us. We need every 7 days to rest. So our spiritual health affects our physical health. Number three, am I living purposefully? In other words, it's important to know why you're alive. You are not on this planet just to use up resources, have fun, live for the weekends, get a job, retire, and die. Life is more than that. God has given you a reason to be here. And if you don't know what that reason is, then you're going to make poor decisions. It doesn't matter if you play video games for hours and hours or watch movies or just fill your life with entertainment. You're just kind of biding time until it's all over. But when you realize God has given you a mission, he has an assignment for you, and he needs, as I said earlier, he needs your body to help carry that out. You'll make different decisions. Somebody asked Bill Hybels, who's got one of the larger churches in Chicago, they said, why do you work out like you do? Because he works out pretty regularly. He goes, well, the studies I've read is that you have 7% more energy if you work out. He goes, and I am so busy, I need that 7%. That's a guy who understands his mission. Now, we try to emphasize that a lot here at Vineyard Community Church. You have an assignment. Vineyard 301, we start talking to you about it, talking about unpacking your spiritual gift mix and your assignment, what you're supposed to be doing. We talk about it a lot. So hopefully the percentage of people here at Vineyard are going down who have no idea what they're supposed to be doing with their life. It's more than just working, living for the weekends, retiring and dying and using up resources. I'm telling you, God has an assignment. And figuring that out is paramount. It's so important because it then starts to help us with our decision making. Proverbs 29:18 says, where there is no vision, people cast off restraint. I might as well click on it. I might as well eat it. I might as well smoke it. I might as well do it. It doesn't matter at all. 1 Corinthians 9 says this, do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? This is the race of life. Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like a man running, say this next word with me, aimlessly, without purpose, just kind of running for running's sake. No. He says, I do not fight like a man beating the air. No, I beat my body and make it a slave, so that after I preach to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. God wants you to be a prize runner. You're running for a prize. You know your goal. You know your mission. It helps you to make decisions that will accomplish that mission. And then number four, so am I offering daily? Am I withdrawing weekly? Am I living purposely? And then fourth, am I honoring fully? This is so important. This is really the number one motivational thing for me. Am I honoring God fully? You see, it's due to him. Because before I knew Christ, I was running wild. I was making bad decisions. I was a wild guy. And then I gave my life to Christ. And you see, what happened was I was owned by the devil before that. The devil owned me. God came to the devil and said, I want Andy. And God says, what's it going to cost? And the devil says, it's going to cost you everything. And it did. It cost him his son, Jesus Christ. He gave it all. And I was bought. See, I was purchased. It cost God everything. Friend, if somebody jumped in front of a car for you and pushed you out of the way and they were killed in the process, I mean, you'd probably go to their funeral. I mean, they gave their life for you. You probably maybe even every year put some flowers on their grave, maybe send some written cards to the loved ones they left behind. That's what we do. When we really get it, say, that person gave their life for me. And God gave his life for me, and he did for you as well. And so I honor him with my body. I honor him with the way I live. Notice this last verse, and then we'll close. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God. You are not your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. So every day I remember, God paid for me. I was purchased. It didn't come free. And I don't have to be a slave to my body. I don't have to be a slave. I don't have to be have mastery. My body doesn't have to have mastery over me on any of those things. My emotions don't have to have mastery over me. God changed it all. And he does it by starting from within, making us brand new. So let's bow our heads and pray. Now, I know I have it being 12:04. And so we start thinking about things. Okay, what am I? I'm going to just ask you to just take a moment now. Because how we respond to God is important. When we read the Bible, that's what we did. We had a Bible study this morning. It's our turn to respond now. We've let God kind of speak his word into our life. So I'm going to ask everybody just to be still and be quiet. Even if you're thinking, I'm not going to listen to that guy. Would you do it for the sake of the person next to you? Maybe God's doing something in their life right now. Maybe they're struggling and you don't even know it. Right now, Heavenly Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit come, put your spotlight on those areas that maybe we're embarrassed about, we're uncomfortable with. Places where we know we don't have victory. We can't seem to break free from things. We have some kind of addictive thing going on. Some kind of self-destructive emotional thing going on. Today I invite you just to quiet yourself. Maybe you're just exhausted. Just going, I'm so tired of all this. Holy Spirit, bring your hope, your living hope right now, Lord. Nobody here has to be a slave if we make ourselves a slave to Christ. What that means is you shift your allegiance. Say, I'm going to be a servant to God. I'm going to let the spirit part of me call the shots. Andy, how do I do that? I mean, I want 2017 to be different than the other years. Now, if you're fine with where you're at, then that's fine if it's working for you. But some of you know it is not. How do you do it? Well, you go to God in prayer, and I'm going to ask you right now, just decide in advance, am I going to say this prayer? Am I going to put my faith in Christ today? Am I going to surrender? Because that's really what Christianity is about. I've tried my way. I'm going to surrender today. Decide right now. Some of you, you're going into 2017 and you're backslidden. You used to be close to God. And you're not that way right now. God's calling you home. God says, I'm not angry with you. I love you. I want you to come home. Some of you just need to invite Christ. You say, I need to be brand new. I'm going to pray with you right now, right where you're at. You just pray. You can either whisper it, pray it in your mind, pray and say, Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus Christ for me. You paid the ultimate price. Make me new. Would you say, I invite your Holy Spirit to dwell in this body, to change me from the inside. You say, God, I give you permission to root out things that are unpleasing to you. Then if you're far from God and you used to be close, say, God, today I'm coming home. God's arms are wide open to receive you. Now let me pray for you. Father, I pray for everyone here that they would make the decision this will be the best year of their life spiritually. This would be a great year of physical growth, that we would honor you, God. We'd offer our bodies to you daily. We'd honor the Sabbath weekly. We'd remind ourselves that we have a purpose. If we don't know what that is, we will pursue that with all diligence so we know what our purpose is. And then together, God, I want to honor you with all of my body, with all of my soul, all of who I am, because I've been bought with a price. You demonstrated your love with action and not just words. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.